NASA plans to retire the International Space Station around 2030, although Russia has committed only until 2028, and the station cannot operate without Russian support. Once retired, the ISS will be decommissioned, with SpaceX providing a deorbit vehicle to guide it to its destruction in the upper atmosphere. Despite this, NASA aims to continue research and astronaut training in low Earth orbit. To achieve this, they have initiated the Commercial LEO Destinations Program, or CLD Program for short. This program is divided into two phases. Phase 1, which began in 2021, saw NASA award grants to three entities to design commercial space stations suitable for NASA's research and training requirements. Phase 2, scheduled for 2026, will involve certifying one or more of these designs for official use by NASA astronauts. Additionally, other US-based companies have the opportunity to propose designs in the second phase. New companies like Vast Space are likely to participate, and there's a possibility that SpaceX might propose using its Starship as a space station. Commercial low Earth orbit destinations. NASA plans to purchase services from these commercial space stations that are owned and operated by private entities. Currently, NASA spends over $3 billion annually on low Earth orbit services, but they aim to cut this expenditure in half through the CLD program. Now that we know how NASA plans to save money, the critical question becomes, can these commercial entities turn a profit? Constructing and launching space station modules is a costly affair, with investments likely running into hundreds of millions of dollars before any revenue is generated. For instance, launching a complete space station using a single Falcon 9 rocket could cost at least $60 million. Additionally, Thales Alenia, a key contractor, has charged Axiom Space 110 million euros for just two pressurized modules. Outfitting these modules involves installing critical systems like life support, power, propulsion, scientific equipment, storage, crew accommodations, airlocks, robotic arms, data links, and telecommunications, all of which must meet stringent NASA standards. This validation and testing process significantly increases costs. Beyond NASA, who else might buy these services? Other space agencies that currently conduct experiments and send astronauts to the ISS are potential customers. Agencies like ESA and national bodies such as the French, German, and Italian space agencies could be interested. Axiom Space has already flown private astronaut missions to the ISS, indicating that these agencies might be eager to use commercial space stations. However, private astronaut missions are limited by high costs and extensive training requirements. One critical challenge is that although NASA labels these stations as commercial, they essentially serve NASA's needs due to the rigorous standards they must meet. These standards, tailored for NASA missions, can make the stations excessively expensive for other uses, compelling commercial providers to charge high fees to offset the cost of compliance. To understand the financial implications better, let's examine some of the specific requirements NASA imposes on future commercial space stations. NASA's requirements for the CLD program. CLD awardees must meet a range of operational, technical, and strategic aspects aimed at providing a smooth transition to a post-ISS era for NASA. On the operational side, NASA expects the stations to support continuous accommodations and training for at least two crew members in low Earth orbit. They also require the capability to handle 200 investigations annually in areas like human research, technology demonstrations, and biological and physical sciences. This means the stations must be equipped with the necessary onboard equipment, power, and communications to support these scientific experiments. In-flight amenities that NASA expects include utilities like power and data services, along with consumables, common use equipment such as tools, centrifuges, 3D printers, pressure chambers, and microscopes must be available, alongside capabilities for small satellite deployment. External robotics and secure communications are also part of the package. As you can see, once you start adding up all these requirements, it adds up to a lot of capability that commercial operations must provide and support. Now, let's move on to the technical requirements NASA requires. The design of the space station should be modular to support future expansion, with multiple docking ports and various facilities such as labs and crew airlocks. The station must work seamlessly with existing and future transportation systems. Think crew and cargo Dragon, Cygnus, and future cargo vehicles like Nyx, Argo, and others. Proposals to NASA must provide detailed plans for commercialization, demonstrating not only how NASA's needs will be met, but outlining plans to attract non-NASA revenue. How much funding will NASA provide to CLD program winners? To assess the commercial viability of these space stations, we need to understand how much funding NASA will allocate to the winning proposals. While exact figures remain unclear, NASA aims to significantly cut its current $3 billion annual expenditure on the ISS. A figure of $1.5 billion per year has been mentioned for post-ISS activities. If NASA selects a single commercial operator and awards them the full $1.5 billion annually, this could provide sufficient financial support for a space station. However, if NASA chooses multiple operators, they would have to split this fixed amount, potentially reducing profitability for each. We also don't know if the European Space Agency will fund missions for their astronauts. Operators with strong European ties, like Starlab, may have an edge. Space stations that can accommodate European cargo vehicles, such as Nyx, are more likely to attract ESA awards. Examples include Starlab and Vast Space's Haven 2. Meanwhile, JAXA, the Japanese space agency, is in talks with NASA about participating in the CLD program, which could lead to JAXA-supported missions to these commercial stations. Mitsubishi, a partner in the Starlab project, would likely benefit from JAXA's involvement. Only time will tell how viable commercial space stations will be. The development of commercial space stations faces several big challenges. The high initial investment and long development cycles raises concerns about the return on investment, with operational costs being large and profits sometime off in the distance, potentially deterring investors. There's also uncertainty about market demand after the ISS is decommissioned. While the ISS has been a hub for research, the transition to a commercial model, where these stations serve a range of customers, is untested. Does this market even exist? Finally, with multiple companies launching their own space stations, there's a risk of market saturation, leading to an oversupply of capacity, which could mean a limited amount of money divided among operators, perhaps causing all of them to fail. In addition to this uncertainty, we have a change of NASA administrator and potential disruptive changes to the human spaceflight policy, with the new administration showing more interest in Mars than the Moon or low Earth orbit. We'll keep you informed on all the news related to commercial space stations and hope we can look forward to a robust commercial operators in LEO later in this decade. That wraps up this video. Be sure to like and subscribe so you see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.